Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is David Kennedy, and I want to welcome you to our Sunday symposium. I'm really pleased to have as our guest this afternoon A.R. Gurney, Pete, to those who know him, the author of the world premiere of Love and Money, and Mark Lamos, the director of Love and Money and the artistic director of the Playhouse. Native of Buffalo, New York, Pete is a graduate of Williams College and the Yale School of Drama, taught literature for many years at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology before leaving that position to be a full-time playwright. He is somewhere in the neighborhood of 50 plays. I'm not going to give an exact number because I've lost count. As well as musical librettos, he's also written a handful of novels. He's a member of the American Academy of Letters, and in 2006 he was inducted into the Theater Hall of Fame, and deservedly so. And Mark has been the artistic director of the Playhouse since 2009. Before that, was artistic director of Hartford Stage for 17 seasons from 1980 to 1997. And has a prolific career also as a director of theater and opera, and has many Pete Gurney plays on his resume, and I am pleased to welcome both of them here today. So Pete, the first thing I want to do is just congratulate you on the success of Love and Money thus far, and really on the, you know, impressive arc of your whole career. I'm particularly struck by how many plays have been produced at the Playhouse. Several world premieres, at least a couple. The Fourth Wall, Love and Money. Any others I don't know about?
What I Did Last Summer.
What I Did Last Summer. So there's several world premieres among 15 or so productions going back decades, bridging both buildings, the new theater and the old theater, three different periods of artistic leadership. That's about as long and durable a relationship with the theater as any I can imagine. I'm wondering if you talk just a little bit about your feelings about Westport, how it started for you, and how it developed.
Well, it's always hard to generalize about these things, but it's always been a kind of home for me. When Jim McKenzie was running it, as I'm sure most of you know, Westport was kind of the center. The Westport Playhouse was the kind of center of the summer touring situation. So I had had a play called Children, which was done here again fairly recently, but it was my first play to be done at Westport with Seda Thompson playing the lead, and that was the way it was. So I learned a lot about how different audiences, because at that time Westport was the jumping off place for the same play that went on all over New England and ended up normally out in Denver. So I learned a great deal because I was really just starting out, how different audiences respond in different ways, and I learned how to rewrite very quickly, because if we moved, say, from Dennis to Falmouth, we might have had a day where we needed to fix a scene. So Westport was a way I not only had the pleasure of speaking to audiences, but I learned more than ever my craft of how to shape and tune the play, and that's continued on through all the other plays that I've had done here, including this one.
It's interesting you mentioned, you know, the art of writing quickly and rewriting quickly. Mark and Pete and Matthew Melfiore, the stage manager, were just conferring in the hallway on the way up here about some minor tweaks and changes that you want to put into this play. So this play is still very much actively being worked on by the two.
Absolutely, absolutely. And that's what I love particularly about the theater, is that it's not just a frozen piece of work. You learn from the audiences. You learn from how they respond or don't respond. And I love to take advantage of that and incorporate it in the work that we're doing at the time.
Do you ever feel that a play of yours is finished, or do you subscribe to that idea that it's never finished, just abandoned? I mean, I wonder if you look at plays from 25 or 30 years ago, like for instance, when we did do Children here in 2009, were you tempted to get in there and work on it some more?
I did.
You did? Okay,
there you go. I did work on it some more. because it had been done in England, but that was a different audience. No, I made some changes. There were problems because when you're working with a touring company, they can't give you that much time. So you can't really read. Even today, even right now, as we were talking, you might see something that you want to adjust. But the actors need time off. You might have a matinee that if they have to act in the matinee and the evening, they're not going to have any time to re-rehearse or change any line. So, it's that kind of process that I like very much, is being able to adjust. But at a certain point, that's it, and then I don't like to change it, and I don't like anybody else to change it.
Mark, your professional relationship with Pete predates your time at the Playhouse. So the fact that you're getting to do this world premiere here on this stage, a stage where many of Pete's plays have been produced for decades, is kind of a coincidence. But could you tell me a little bit about how the two of you first kind of were put together artistically, and what that project was, and how your relationship developed?
Well, when I was artistic director at Hartford Stage, I found myself a Midwesterner, basically, and though I'd spent time in New York and as an actor, etc., I found myself at Hartford in an area and a situation that was very high WASP. And I was fascinated by them. They were on my board and they were in the community, and it was very interesting to be a part of, or to observe these people who I liked very, very much, who were pretty much like Cornelia here. And had her values and whatnot. And so I thought I would investigate that more, and somebody said, you ought to read the plays of A.R. Gurney. And I remember falling in love with The Middle Ages, a play of yours that Jack Gilpin and Annie McDonough did off Broadway, which was just wonderful. And The Perfect Party, which had another friend of mine in it, Kate McGregor Stewart, and that was at Playwrights Horizons. So I started reading Pete's plays and stumbled across Children, and I thought, well, we'll do it here in Hartford. And that's when I first met Pete, I think. And then Jack O'Brien, a director who was running the Old Globe in San Diego, a few years later, he called and said, there's this play by Pete Gurney, but it's an enormous cast, and I mean to do it with another theater in order to share the costs. Would you be interested? And that was called The Snowball. Is based on the novel Pete wrote about dance cotillion. And so that was our second time working together. But we really didn't get, I think, to know each other until my husband and I moved to Sherman, Connecticut. And Pete and Molly live in Roxbury, and so we were kind of neighbors. And we began to see each other in a social way. And that led to, I think, us doing more work together.
Not wanting to put either of you on the spot, but long relationships are usually successful relationships. To what do you attribute the success of your collaborative relationship, Pete?
Well, it's hard to say. I just get along with Mark. We've had our disagreements. In fact, we had one fairly recently. but we both can pull out of it. And we both respect each other. I don't know, as you probably have noticed, if you've come to Westport a lot, he's the most articulate man I've ever seen. I mean, he can get up with no notes and speak to audiences with great clarity. And it's this, and I noticed that. I remember going to some kind of a benefit when he was running Hartford. And I was at his table, and they said, it's your turn to speak, Mark. I didn't see him reach for his notes. He just got up and let everybody know what he felt, and it was very impressive. And he does that with the actors, too. So I wanted to work with a guy who wasn't always fussing around, who speaks from the heart, and I think Mark does.
Pete, I want to ask you something that you wrote in the program about Love and Money, is that it was intended as a valedictory of sorts, that you were saying farewell to the WASP world, and that you thought at the time that you were writing, you may have changed your mind since then, that this was going to be your last play. And I'm just curious what it was like to sit down at the keyboard to write your last play. Did you feel a particular responsibility or burden, or did you feel freer than you felt writing other plays? I mean, was it a different experience for you with that in mind?
No, not really. I was asked to have a commit myself to a season at in New York at the in the theater, and I had to write two plays, and I had to respond to their production of two plays, and then I had to write a third. That was part of the deal. And so I said, okay, I'm 84 years old. I don't think I have another play in it, but I had an old plot in me. And the old plot was about a plot I swiped from somewhere.
Like Shakespeare.
But as it turned out, the plot was about an imposter imposing himself on a family. But the more I fussed with it, I said, there's a better story here than just this kind of melodramatic dramatic thing. And I myself was old enough to know that my wife and I, our children were out of the nest. We were living too elaborate a life. We had too many paintings on the wall, too many couches that were broken, too much stuff. So I suddenly found myself writing a play about a woman. Why a woman rather than a man? Because I think the woman tends to be more the custodian of the culture, and how she was trying to give away the culture. And I said, I hardly ever use the word wasp in my plays. Other people might use it occasionally when they're looking at my plays. But I said, damn it, I'm really writing about my own culture, as every culture has decided to move on out as another culture takes its place. So the play slowly transferred from just a melodramatic little one act into a more of a, still one act, but longer, and into sort of a study of the world I grew up in, how the music we liked, how we felt, and the problems of that culture. And I tried along the way to refer to other plays I had written, like The Cocktail Hour, Richard Corey, all these things. I tried to make it a kind of summing up, not simply of the culture I grew up in, but the world I'd written about. The dining room, for example, I talk about it this way. So somehow it took shape in a way I didn't expect it to. But Mr. Lamos here gave it more shape, and what you saw this afternoon was sort of the way we wanted to be.
Of course, the play's so much about somebody whose sense of their own culture has evolved, or that they recognize it because their culture is in the midst of a vastly changing world. But that subject or that theme of change, I mean, I think of The Dining Room, which we did here 2 years ago, which is a 1981-82 play, so that's over 30 years old, and that subject of the world changing around people is sort of very much sewn through that play as well. So
yeah.
Has that been something that has been a fascination of yours for a long time?
I've become more and more aware of it. When I first started writing plays, like Children, for example, if you look at that play Children, which was swiped to some degree from a John Cheever story, that the culture is solid and responsive. It has its problems nonetheless, but it's not declining in any way. I know as I wrote over the years, I became more and more aware there are other cultures in the world besides mine. Mine maybe has had its say. And the best way I can talk about that is to write plays which somehow both celebrate and at the same time show the difficulties within the country. At the end of my play, the one you just saw, I tried to hold on to what I thought was important about my culture. And she's telling people, when you go in there, listen to what other people are saying, don't interrupt, all those things my mother used to tell me. And those values just of straight manners are still important to me, so we end with those. But along the way, the leading lady, Cornelia, gives up a lot in order because she doesn't need a fur coat anymore, doesn't want a fur coat, she doesn't want this, she doesn't want that, and I admire that too.
Once you had your first read of the play, Mark, which was sometime a year or so ago, how much has it changed since then, I'm curious, and how much has it changed over the course of the rehearsal process? Because I think one thing that a lot of people don't really know, unless they work in the theater, is what it's like to work on a world premiere, and I think that's one of the most fascinating aspects of making theater. Mm-hmm. Could you talk a little bit about that?
Sure. I mean, when I read what Pete sends me, I find it pretty complete, and make little notes about this and that. Mostly they're just questions for him. I think we should remove this, or it's more about things that don't make sense to me, or I don't quite see how something follows something else. But it's important to just hear the writer talk about what he's done. And this play, has undergone more change really than almost anything we've done before. We've done a number of premieres together, and I think the last one, Black Tie, primary stages in New York, was just a word here and a word there, a half a speech here, half a speech there. Very, very little. And here we began, I did first read it a year ago, and I think now we're on, only because of many minor changes that have reshaped significant aspects of the play, the seventh draft. And it has reshaped itself to a certain extent. One thing that happened that was maybe of interest to you is that when we were in audition, we did the reading at the Signature Theater, which commissioned the play in New York, and very, very good actors read the parts. Maureen was the only one, Cornelia here was the only one who's a constant, and we recast everyone else. And we were auditioning for the role of Harvey, the lawyer, in New York. And we were seeing, young men in their 30s who were very sort of waspy, very sort of New England, white, this, that, the other. And a few actors that they brought us were not that. They were a little more working class. They were Irish, or they were Italian, or they were Jewish. And then I said, why don't we see more of those men? Because there's something that's in this that sounds kind of interesting. And Pete felt that way too. We both got sort of excited about this other kind of actor playing that role. And that really changed. He went back and made him Latvian. He gave him the girlfriend. I'm not sure the girlfriend. We had a wife before. I can't quite remember. And just subtly changed various aspects of this guy who became, instead of kind of a hotshot lawyer, more of a pencil pusher, more trying to succeed, kind of frustrated a little bit, nice looking, and thrown to the lions by the older lawyers who had it with her, in that firm. So it was a subtle change that we were very, I think, pleased with. We certainly loved Joe, who plays it. But it was stuff like that happened. And then when he sings, for instance, at the end of the play, that was a very late edition. That was just 2 or 3 weeks ago. And it was such a surprise that Pete said, I think this should happen. I said, gosh, I just don't see this at all. I can't imagine this. And the actor, Joe, he ran with the ball, and he said, just let me think about this overnight and come back tomorrow. And then Pete sent a couple of rewrites to me the next day saying, I know you're not crazy about this yet, but see if this helps it a little bit. And it's that sort of thing, but it's been constant. It's been almost every day an exchange about one or the other small aspect of the play now. but three new ideas came this morning, and we're going to try to implement them. But, I mean, you know, they're the same idea, that a rewording or a slight shift of focus or the taking out of one word, it's been very challenging for the actors, because he'll take a speech that they've been doing and then decide to reword it just slightly. And it's very challenging for them to be able to just rearrange the words, take one sentence out, put it at the end, etc. But it's that kind of fine-tuning that he's been doing, which has been very, very, you know, I think, wonderful for the play as we go along. So it's still a very living entity. You know?
Yeah, in fact, I think that it's safe to say that I thought, okay, I owe the signature a play, I'll write a play. But I didn't, but I'm old, and so I'll write, I don't have that much creative juice immediately, and I'll write some mechanical thing. But with it, maybe because of the Westport beginning for this play, all the old habits of the youth came in. Like, why can't I rewrite this? I'll give you another example. We had a reading up of the signature, and there was, at the end of the play, this Irish maid comes on and says a few things and goes off. And it was beautifully played by an actor named Beth Fowler. Am I right?
Yep.
And I said to myself, at the end of Mark, I said, you know, we need more, we need to see more of her. So by now I think she comes on four or five times. And I said, I said that. I don't think it would have happened if I hadn't, just to respond to David's first question, if I hadn't been in this environment where I was used to doing exactly that with Jim McKenzie over the years, trying to quickly squeeze something else in. And it's been a great pleasure to do that. So that would be, and to talk about our laughing and thing. I said we need. I was thinking I couldn't sleep. I said we need one more thing to happen the second time we bring out that player piano. We just need something. And so I said, what Cole Porter song could this guy possibly sing? And I remembered that wonderful song, You Get Out of Town. So I wrote this, I showed it to Mark, I said, he comes on, how does he know the song? He's a Latvian lawyer. And I said, well, because he had to defend plagiarism.
So that was the next day.
That was great.
So then I went up to this guy, Joe, and said, you don't by any chance sing. And he says, I do, I like to sing. So all that happened fairly recently, as Mark pointed out, and it happened in this context of this wonderful theater, which is open to this kind of fooling around in order to make it better.
You know, the Agnes story is a slightly longer one, actually, because the first draft I read, Agnes didn't appear at all. She was off stage in the kitchen, etc. And I said to PG, you know, should we see Agnes maybe? Because she sounds so interesting. And so then Pete said, yeah, maybe that's a good idea. In the next draft, she did appear, and that's what we listened to at the signature. And I said to him, man, I think you should make more of her. And he said, well, I don't want to write a wisecracking Thelma Ritter type maid who just comes on for no reason but to get a laugh or two. I said, that's valid, okay, good. But then, as we auditioned women for the part, again, when we found Pamela, we were like, okay, and it sort of led to another final, you know, Agnes that I just love. And I mean, it really was, she was very much a part of it.
Yeah, that's inspiring. Right. That's absolutely true.
So this brings up something interesting, of course, which is that because the play's never been done before, the actor who plays any given part has quite an influence on how the role is shaped. I mean, obviously, any time a play is produced, an actor's going to find things in it, but you're in the room with the actors, and you're responding to what they're doing. I mean, I remember coming to rehearsal one day, and you guys were all sort of subtly debating sort of slight word changes, and the actors felt completely free as collaborative artists to make suggestions. Yeah. Can you talk just a little bit about the relationship of this particular cast for you as playwright and you as director? I mean, I know, as you say, Maureen has been with it for a long time.
I've worked with Maureen in several other plays, but particularly a play called Later Life. And so I knew her talent. And Mark, of course, has played opposite her. He played Hamlet to her Gertrude. So he knew her talent, I knew her talent, and I never saw anybody else but Maureen playing this part, partly because she doesn't play it young, she's young enough to remember her lines.
And to incorporate changes,
actually. So that influenced me a lot. And as we talked about, when we needed another music. Oh, I wanted to say this. When we were casting this, Mark said, I think when you bring up, you love that song, that Cole Porter song about one more old fashioned. I said, what? It's a great song, and it's indicative of the culture I come from. And he said, I see an Asian person singing it. And I
isn't that right?
And I thought, we can talk about it. I said, why does he do that? And then I said, I know why he's doing that, because this is becoming a play about culture. Yeah. And the Asian culture is represented, so it went on like that. I don't want to bore you with some. There's nothing more boring than some of the creative twists that we went through. But these are examples.
Did Maureen ever have a kind of an approach to a specific moment or a speech or a line that wasn't one you would necessarily, imagined as you sat down to write it? And yet, as soon as you heard it, you thought, that actually is the right way to do that.
Yeah, is she? In almost every line.
Well, that's a remarkable collaboration.
Yeah. Well, she, and Mark was insistent that I get certain rewrites done ahead of time because it'll take Maureen time to become familiar with the language, familiar with the lines, so she's not just stumbling up there. But she's a wonderful study, and when she first performed it in front of an audience, she was letter perfect. So we were very lucky for that because it's a big, long part. But it is interesting. Here's another example. When we did it, when we opened it three or four days ago, Tuesday night, some of the audience felt that she was too young to be going into a nursing home. Well, she's not going into a nursing home. She's going to one of these. Yeah, fancy assisted living thing, but not even assisted living. Fancy retirement place, I'm sure you all know about. And they're great places to go to. There are a lot of interesting people there. So I think Mark mentioned this. We think you might be too young, so I'll say, I'll change it. I won't call it a nursing home. We'll find something else to call it. Yeah. And Maureen herself decided to play it a little older, so she played it. I think she probably the first performance she was probably around 68 or 70, but now I think you'd agree she's playing somebody about 75, and it made a lot of difference. There are all these things that go on within the theater, and this is a wonderful, wonderful place to try them out.
She's also very. She has to make everything absolutely organic for herself. And in the process of doing that, without being any kind of a diva, she draws us into that process. So if she's not, she says, I can't make sense of this. I try to explain what might make sense for her. If that does it, that's fine. It's cut and dried, it's over. Yep, fine, thanks, I can do that. If not, Pete suggests, well, what if we take that line out and put something over here that says that, maybe that would work, let me think about that. So it was very, but she, that need to not just do what we asked of her, or just do the words that are on the page, but to actually make complete sense to herself was a huge help in getting it to where it is now. And that shift that she made, everybody made a shift between the first preview, which I urge you never to come to. Unless you're like pulling wings off of butterflies. That kind of person, I have a whole house of them on Tuesday night. There they are. No, they're great. That audience is wonderful. But because they help us. And what shifted after everyone played the first night was that she became older. Scott became more vulnerable. Harvey became more likable, less aggressively trying to get Scott out of the way. And Agnes got more of a twinkle in her eye about this black guy. And all of that, you know, is the kind of thing that you learn watching a play with its very first live audience. And I'm not the only one learning it. Pete's learning it. I'm learning it. The actors are learning it, even as they do it. So that the next day's rehearsal, everything flowed very quickly because everybody sort of agreed this is where we had to go. And it was difficult to shift some of the moments, but that's where the change began. And when I went into her dressing room on Wednesday night, I said, hi, how are you doing? And she looks a little older. And I thought, oh God, none of us are sleeping. And she said, I've just added a little bit here and a little bit here. And she mentioned an actress who's we love very much, who's been felled by a stroke, unfortunately. And she said, you want me to be her, don't you? And I said, there's something there that maybe you could use, Franny.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And she said, I know. And she got on stage, and it was just this revelation. And when it was over, I went to her dressing room afterwards, and I knocked on the door. She said, come in. And I said, where's she been living all this time? But that's the accumulation of an actor's process, these stabs in the dark, trying different things with a lot of conviction. And then slowly they begin to kind of come together. Some are discarded, but some pulled together into this beautiful sort of whole, which is what she has now.
Can you talk a little bit about Gatsby and why it was important to you in this play?
Well, I think most people agree now, it's a major American novel, a great book. But I can remember coming across it when I was at Williams College. This was in the, maybe it was even before, but maybe when I was at school. I came across it, and my mother was a big reader. I said, I just read this terrific book called The Great Gatsby. And she said, oh, well, she said, there were a number of serious writers in the 20s that just haven't lasted. One was F. Scott Fitzgerald. The other was Michael Arlen, whose work has not lasted, but who wrote The Green Hat. Garbo was in a movie written by him, and there was a play called The Green Hat. But Fitzgerald was looked at that way. He died, and suddenly people began to read him, and by the time I got to college, everybody read The Great Gatsby. It wasn't always discussed in class, but we all read it the way we read The Catcher in the Rye, for example. Just a terrific book to read. And because he did grow up in Buffalo, I used to hear that as he became more popular, my father would say, well, you know Fitzgerald lived here. So it was the combination of first finding him, I thought, myself, and the fact that was reconfirmed by the, when people started writing about him and thinking about him, the fact that he was from my hometown or started there, and many of those early stories I know exactly where all the kids gathered to play softball after dinner. It's a big square in Buffalo, surrounded by houses. It's not a public square. If you read those early short stories, I've forgotten the title of the compilation, you'll see what that was about. But then we have this, at Westport, they have this wonderful dramaturg who did some more work on Fitzgerald and Buffalo, and he came back with all the names of the women that used to dance with Fitzgerald at dancing school in Buffalo, which we all had to go to. And I can remember, you know, when I read what this dramaturg just wrote, I can remember my father saying, "Oh yes, he used to dance with Doc Rogers." So you ask why, so Fitzgerald was very much a part of my soul by then. And so I imposed that character.
As is Buffalo.
As is Buffalo.
I'm curious, you know, you wrote this essay in this really wonderful book, or contributed to this really wonderful book called The Play That Changed My Life, that the American Theater Wing put out a few years ago. And I'm wondering if you could just share with us, what was the play that changed your life?
Which one was it?
Oh, and you were talking about seeing Catherine Purnell. When she was touring.
Yeah, Mark directed that play. It's called The Grand Manor. Right. And I got, because of Buffalo, Catherine Purnell came from Buffalo. I got special permission to go take a train down to see her in Antony and Cleopatra, because we were studying it at school. And so I got out of this rather tight boarding school, came down, and I sent a note backstage saying, "I'm Peter Gurney, and I believe you know my grandmother," and the answer came back from backstage, "Come back after the play." So I saw Catherine Cornell in Antony and Cleopatra, and I kept thinking, did the world really fall apart in order to go to bed with Catherine Cornell? I just couldn't believe she was the most ultimate temptress, but she was a very good actor. My real experience was not the play at all, but meeting her afterwards and her generosity, and I said I wanted to be in the theater, and she said, do it. And she was a very warm, nice woman, very much like my grandmother's. So that's
was the theater an acceptable profession? I mean, given the world in which you grew up, were you encouraged in that dream?
I wasn't encouraged by my family because they thought it was slightly vulgar, and they didn't think I had much talent. But I
tell the story about your father.
So I had a play opening in New York. My first play, it wasn't very good, but it had a good cast. Marie Abraham was in it, Alan Taylor was in it, and I was too nervous to be there, but my parents wanted to come down and see it, and they sat right next to Clive Barnes, who was the critic. My father, who prided himself on being a very amusing entertainer in his own speeches, he kept nudging Clive Barnes saying, "Do you think this is any good?"
Did he know who he was? Did he know that this is the chief critic of the time?
I've never gotten to admit it, but Clive Barnes, I'm sure, was writing terrible things in it. So I was in the bar across the street. It was done at this place, which is still there, called the Actors Playhouse. And my agent came across and said, "Get rid of that father."
That's a great story. I want to make sure we leave time for the audience to ask questions. I just want to finish up myself by just asking, I know that you have Sylvia is being revived on Broadway, and you have had this year-long celebration of your work at the Signature Theater. So this has been kind of quite a banner year for you. Were you involved in the selection of what those signature plays would be? In other words, did they sort of consult with you?
A little bit. For those who don't know, there were, I have two plays done, one in the fall, and one more recently, I suppose, in the winter. One was called The Wayside Motor Inn, the other was called What I Did Last Summer. And Jim Houghton, who runs the Signature, said, these are the plays we'd like to do. And I said, don't touch them, they're losers, they're losers. Don't. I sound like my father. neither play had done any kind of, gotten any kind of reviews or anything. They'd really been slammed. And Jim Houghton said, no, I think there's value in these plays, we're gonna do them. And they did them very well, and they were fairly well received. So that was exciting, particularly exciting for me at my age to discover that these plays I wrote when I was much younger had some real value. And then we have this one, of course, which has even more value.
You rediscovered some of the creative energy of your younger years.
I did. I think that I wouldn't have put it that way myself, but I think that that's right.
Excellent.
But I can tell you.
Questions of either Mark or Pete? Yes, ma'am, on the aisle.
I have a question. I happen to work for Save the Children, and I wondered why you chose Save the Children for her to give her money to, and if you'd like to give us royalties for helping to keep with the children.
Well, I've supported, I've been involved and supported Save the Children for a number of years. I like the organization and the people that I've met from there, I really like. But also there's a practical reason that you can Save the Children, the title of the organization says everything. So she said, do you still want to save the children? You know, just write that up. You still want to save the children? Yes, I do. So it's a very crisp, accurate title and a very good organization.
Thank you. That's very nice. Yeah.
It also feeds thematically into the fact that her children fell through the.
Yeah.
So she wants to save children around the world.
I see a hand over there. Yes, ma'am.
Was she having a senior moment over here when she came and she couldn't remember?
The question is whether Cordelia, when she sits down over here stage, right, is she having a senior moment there?
Yeah. Okay. Yes. And she, I said when we rehearsed it, I said, I want you to make the audience think that you, as an actress, are having a moment. It needs to be that believable.
I am. It was.
Did you want a sort of suggestion? But anyway, I'm wondering if that transition could be somehow cleaner. I can't see you.
Stand up.
Well, yeah, I couldn't shift as integratively as I would like to between what up till that point and then from then on. And you know, that was like turning some sort of a corner that I thought she's forgotten her lines. Yeah. I'm sorry, but and then I thought, okay, well I don't know. But that was the point where I would
good point.
Maybe that's helpful. I don't know.
Well, you got it. Something goes on with her where she says I don't know what the next step is.
She's completely at a loss.
She's completely at a loss.
Oh, okay.
She wants to put a button on things. And the maid comes in and says, are you all right?
Yeah.
And then the maid kind of helps her back from this near TIA moment. So you've kind of actually got what we're doing. Even though you didn't like it.
Yes, in the front row here.
And you were talking about the first night. Do you remember if they laughed as much the first night?
You're talking about Tuesday night.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. and the changes that you've made.
The laughs were all there, but they weren't as big as they became the next night. And then they've stayed that size at every performance.
And that's often true with the first preview of a comedy, that you're still trying to find a rhythm. Right?
Yeah, and the actors aren't as confident. They don't know whether that line is going to get a laugh or not, so they don't land on it always as strong as they could.
Yeah, they're testing the line rather than maybe committing to it as much as they will when they hear a little giggle. And then the next night they'll commit to that and they'll get a bigger laugh. Yeah. But I always used to feel, you know, when I was acting, there are few people on earth who have to acquire more arrogance than actors. It just takes so much energy to put yourself out there in front of people. But I remember saying to myself, really, 50% of the work is done in the rehearsal hall with the director and everything. And the other 50% is really on the first preview, because suddenly you see what you have or don't have, you know, what makes sense, what doesn't make sense. What you need to keep striving for, what's always going to be things to deal with, etc. So the audience is a huge part of the, you know, where the play starts to land. No matter what it is, whether it's Antony and Cleopatra or Love and Love.
There's a woman in the aisle. Yes.
You all mentioned in the beginning of your conversation that you still have a few changes that you'd like to make. So if we think back,
for the end of this run, what would we see different? That's a great question. What might be different in 2 weeks?
You might come back and you say it, and you might say it's exactly the same thing, and I want my money back.
Sometimes, I mean, that actually brings up something serious, which is sometimes the changes that a playwright and a director are making are quite infinitesimal, and they're very important to the overall mechanics of it, but wouldn't necessarily leap out at an audience as noticeable. Is that fair to say?
I think it is fair to say, David. I mean, I'm not sure you would notice. I don't think you'll see any major changes in terms of what happens in the play. It's pretty safe to say, don't you think? I mean, but I mean, small ways of getting to points being made. Subtle propping up of objectives, you know, set little places where things are explained slightly more. Mm-hmm. That sort of thing, maybe, you know, is kind of what we're looking at now.
Yes, in the center, sir.
Yeah, a brief comment and then a question. I think it's called locking, Latvian Joe. It seemed like wherever he was in the scene, you know, wherever this was on the stage, really represented what was going on. It was kind of shunted to the side here, and then he was right next to the woman when he was Cunningham, when he was allied with her against the interloper who was trying to get money, and then near the end when he was doing the musical piece, he was in front of that mini proscenium. It looked like you had created that, and it was very alive. And my question is the line, I even forget who spoke it, but it was said, the acting is the last refuge of, acting is what the con man does when he goes legit. I had the sound of that maybe you said that somewhere and it was just such a weird remark that you said, I gotta get published and find a home for it, or did it come organically from the writer?
I promise you that came from the writing. I was, we were rounding the corner, coming to the end, and now maybe other people have said it, and it's probably a good thing if they have. I sort of found that at the end, and
that was a late addition. Really,
I think it was. Yeah.
And then I think we talked about con artist versus con man.
Yes.
And juxtaposing those, and Maureen had feelings about that too.
Yeah.
So what do you anticipate in 20 years when cultural change happens with our relationship on race? What do you think will happen to this country? What will the differences be?
Well, can I speak to that? You never really know. Because audiences are willing, I mean, if you see a Philip Barry play, you see the Philadelphia Story, for example, just to use it, say, a high comedy, which was set, I think, in 1939. I don't think the war is even happening, and the values are there, but the audiences are willing to give themselves to the play and accept that vision at that time. So I don't think it necessarily can always be the case that when you write a play that speaks immediately, that it immediately becomes dated. I think audiences go to the theater knowing when they go to Shakespeare, you know, the world has changed in some ways, but they, with good audiences, and we tend to get them here, they give themselves to the play and enter into the world of the play. And I hope that would happen with this one.
One thing we talked about during rehearsals, you know, Pete started writing this play over a year ago. And in that year, there have been such, you know, horrific and sensibility altering situations with primarily young black men, and then this ghastly tragedy in Charleston. All of which, you know, you, as you go into rehearsal, I think we went into rehearsal right after that horrific moment, and, you know, it's there for you when you're working, and you can't quite tell where will it go from here. I mean, hopefully things will get better, but right now, at least according to the New York Times poll the other day, they're worse than they've ever been in terms of race relations in this country. I think, though, you know, just last week I read a wonderful play by a black writer, Charles Fuller, called A Soldier's Play, which is about, you know, an all-black unit in the Second World War in a terribly racist town down south, and won the Pulitzer Prize in 1980 or 81, I think. But he fully captures what it must have been like to be those men back then, all those years ago, and it seems extraordinarily shocking to read now, you know, from the language that they use about themselves to the way they try to deal with the white culture, you know. It will always be, I think, whenever any play deals with any sort of cultural, anthropological situation, societal situation, it might be dated in 10, 25, 30 years, then often, you know, it'll find another resurgence as people look at it again and see it as either an artifact of its time or an artifact of its time that speaks to their own current times. It's impossible to say, but it's gotta be said, you know.
And you can't write for posterity, right? I mean, you really have to write
for that.
For now.
For now.
And just keep your fingers crossed.
Some litter was being advertised in the Buffalo Evening News, and I just had a basket in the front of my bicycle. I bicycled out because the litter was being given away free. They were kind of mutts, really. Put this little dog in the basket, came back, and told my family, I've got this, I want it. Then when they sent me away to school, the first published work I ever had was a short story in the school magazine called Will He Remember? Which was about, will the dog remember me when I come back? And it has a terribly frightening ending, because in the story, I'm riding back from the railroad station with my father, and I see the dog waiting in front, and I yell to the dog. The dog runs out and gets run over and killed. And then the last line was, he remembered all right.
And on that rather down note, we need to bring our afternoon to a close, and I want to thank you so much for taking the time.